Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining this webinar Beyond the Crisis. We're very honored to have you all here today. Well, maybe not physically, but at least virtually. As you can see, and you will see, we are here with quite a group, and we hope to entertain you today during this hour. Maybe as a few technicalities, we are going to try and make this a live conversation, and we're going to have you invited to actually join the conversation and to ask questions to make it as lively as possible. The way we would like to do that is for you to pick your phone up and to scan the QR code that you are about to see. You can do that by opening your camera and scan the QR code. You will see a screen in which you can actually type questions and answers. It's more or less like video chatting, but then a little bit different. So please, throughout the course of the session, please do so. As a little test, we're going to give you a little bit of time to do that while we insert a bit of a poll to see with what mindset you are here today. Please pick up your camera and scan the QR code. The poll that we would like to ask you, or the poll question that we'd like to ask you, is in what way is your organization impacted by COVID-19? It varies from my organization is highly impacted to and I'm really struggling to survive. My organization is impacted, but so far it's actually quite manageable. My organization is not at all that much impacted, so I actually don't feel the change. To the final question, my organization is impacted in a positive, actually, and in a very fruitful manner. So we're kind of hoping for everyone to actually ask that question. At the same time, when you ask that question, I would like to introduce the folks that I have here with me, starting with our CEO, Hans Honig. Welcome. Thank you very much for joining.
Thanks.
Franka Morsink, CEO of the Jaarbeurs. John Luijs, our partner at Deloitte Healthcare and Life Sciences, and Peer Swinkels of the Swinkels Family Brewers. Thank you for joining. Maybe we can see the outcome of the poll while we're at it. I'm hopeful that everybody has actually found the QR code. It shows that most of you have actually answered that the organization is impacted, but so far it's been in a manageable way. So thanks. It actually shows that the technology works for today. We're going to do that quite a couple of times because we would like to really make this interactive. I'm going to start by handing the floor to Hans for setting the scene and hearing your thoughts on the matter.
Yeah.
Hans.
Thanks, Laura. Well, thanks you all for joining. I'm really pleased that we have more than 250 participants today, and actually with a very diverse background from different sectors, different countries. And I think that's very valuable to share a cross-sector perspective. And I'm really looking forward to the panel discussion. So again, thanks for joining. The theme for today is Act Now to Thrive in a COVID and Post-COVID World. And I think that Henry Kissinger actually brilliantly summarized it. And he knows about managing crisis. He said that the historic challenge of leaders is to manage crisis while building the future. And that is actually directly related to the theme for today. And what I notice when I talk to other decision makers, to CEOs, to CFOs, that our share of mind is rapidly moving from responding, from recovery, responding to thriving and to more structural interventions. John will share later insights about the dynamics of the virus and the impact on the business and on businesses and the economy at large. And one conclusion is that in all scenarios, we believe that there is significant impact for quite a prolonged period of time, as long as we don't have a vaccine for the virus, and that we will have constant disruptive intervals. But on top of that, I think that the crisis is profound and will have a huge impact, and that will lead to some structural shifts. Some of those shifts are already happening, but those will be accelerated. Let me mention a few. The most important, in my view, is first a different social contract between society and businesses. I think the call from society is even more to business to move to a more responsible and sustainable business model. Look to the discussion in the Dutch Financial Times this weekend. I think there will be a change in the role of institutions, maybe a bigger role for governments, and in global relation, the risk of protectionism. Another key one is the changes in consumer behavior. We do a poll every 2 weeks in several countries, and we see different, different patterns. But the key question there is it structural or temporary? But part of it will be structural. And then last on my knees, I think that there is an increased need to address bigger challenges in society with multiple stakeholders across public, private, in ecosystems, and leveraging technology. In short, that's a world with a high uncertainty, structural shifts, and I believe also with significant opportunities. And again, that's for the discussion. That's the discussion today. I would like to hand over to John, who will provide insight in the dynamics and also describe what key elements in the game plan of corporates should be in the coming period.
We are going to allow for the public to actually ask questions to John, so it's not a one-way street. So let's see how we can heat up the floor for him. John.
Yes, thank you, Hans. Thank you, Laura. So indeed, my name is John Luijs. I'm a partner in our healthcare practice. And I think that's also, I'm one of the authors of the Beyond the Shock article. And I think maybe that's also one of the differentiators of our article. Eh? I think there are a lot of articles being written about COVID and about the impact that COVID-19 will have short-term or long-term on our corporate clients. The way we build up our thinking about it is, first of all, from a healthcare perspective. Eh? So we, in the beginning of this crisis, there were a lot of things in the media and a lot of reports coming out on you know, what the mortality numbers were, what the health impact was of a COVID infection, what the R naught, if you remember it, is. Eh? And so what we set out to do is first really understand the dynamics of the virus. We want to understand, if you wouldn't have any interventions, what would COVID actually do to society? What would be, how many people would be contaminated? What would be the impact of such a infection? If you actually understand that, so if you understand the dynamics of the virus in a data-driven way and you understand what it would do to society, then you can also predict pretty well the different government interventions. And if you can predict the health system impact and the government interventions, you can actually predict the kind of economic climate that our corporate clients will need to operate in. Yeah? So that's the basis of our article. So starting from the main conclusions, and then we can go into some of these details and into the data. So our first conclusion is that COVID-19 is far less deadly than we originally thought. And I will go deeper into that, but if you remember, originally the World Health Organization said the mortality rate of COVID is 3.4%. If you look at the official data in countries such as Italy, but also the Netherlands, it's 10%. You now also hear voices like Maurice de Hond saying it's 0.5%, which is a factor 20 different. Our insight is it's probably closer to that 0.5%. It's also very much skewed to the older population. But even when it's far less deadly, we will still need interventions in the coming year. So that's number one. The second main conclusion is that we will not return to business as usual after this first shock. Eh? So the worst part of the shock was end of March, beginning of April. I think actually the recovery already started from half of April. Eh? And the numbers you see are just now the death tolls, et cetera, are a bit slower in what you see. But the recovery has been started for quite a while in terms of our health system. We will have a much better summer, but still it will not be business as usual because, as Hans said, in the next year, we will have new outbreaks. It will probably not be a big second wave. It will probably be multiple small regional waves with interventions. So we will have renewed virus outbreaks with interventions until we have a vaccine, and this vaccine will probably be around the summer of 2021. Now, the government interventions in the coming 12 months will not be a big lockdown like we have now, but will be much more of an escalation scheme where in some areas at some point, you know, we will work more from home, then we won't have live events, then we will close off bars and restaurants and maybe even schools again, but maybe not. And so it will be much more an escalation scheme and much less 0 to 1, let's say. So what does that mean, conclusion number 4? It will mean that in the short term, in the next year, we will not go back to normal. But also, we will not have a fundamentally forever changed world. Some things might change, but some will not. Because from the summer of 2021, give or take a few months, we could go back to normal. We could go back to 2019. So the big question is, what will have changed permanently and what not? So now going to conclusion number 5, before we go there, I think a very important thing, if you remember one thing of this webcast or this webinar, is our belief is that we will have two different worlds. And as a company, you should prepare to be successful in those two different worlds in terms of time. We will have a world from now on till probably summer of 2021, which I would call the disruption interval world, which will be a very COVID-19 dominated time where there will be times that really resemble business as usual and everything will feel fine and we feel like we're recovering, and then we'll have setbacks and disruptions to the supply chain, disruptions to the consumer behavior, etc. The 1.5 meter economy. This will be the coming year. And then we will have the true post-COVID world, which will be from summer of 2021 till long term. Now, conclusion number 5 is, in this disruption interval world, to be successful, you should be able to understand and predict maybe even the interventions and what impact they will have on your industry. And within your industry, since probably the industry impact will be the same, you should prepare to beat your competitors and to create opportunities by being more robust and more adaptive in handling these shocks, in handling these disruptions. For the longer term, so the world beyond COVID, the real post-COVID world from summer of 2021, you need to understand which changes are temporary and which are structural. We originally said, don't bet your company on a 1.5 meter economy. It's great to win in a 1.5 meter economy, but only if the payback time for your investment is exactly 12 to 18 months and not longer. So make sure you don't overinvest in temporary changes, or make sure that if you have the feeling that in your ecosystem or in your competitions people are doing it, you take the other side of that deal. Now, in the end, we want to make a positive story. So, and that positive story, by the way, as time goes by, gets easier and easier. So early March, that was harder, and everybody was still very much focusing on recovering and responding. I think now it's very clear that, you know, the next 12 months will be a shaky 12 months. There will be an unpredictable 12 months. And the good things is, as most, you know, financial traders actually know, but times of uncertainty and confusion are great times to actually thrive if you understand what's happening better and faster than the competition, and if you act faster and more decisively. Going to the details then. So just to take you into how the dynamics of the virus works, and I will be brief. So there are only actually 4 things to understand. But first, it's the right side of this graph that you're seeing. And that's probably the most famous graph in the crisis, and you probably have seen it quite a lot. It's the famous flatten the curve. So what it says is the gray area is if we don't do anything, then our health system capacity will be overwhelmed. And, you know, that will start with the most scarce or critical capacity, which is our intensive care capacity. But even if we would have unlimited intensive care, it would be just a normal hospital beds or nursing staff or face masks or whatever. But if we don't act, our health system will be overwhelmed. And why? Because everybody will get sick at the same time, so in a too short period of time. And it's important to understand that the goal of flattening the curve is not to eradicate COVID. We're pretty much past that. It's not even to minimize the amount of deaths, though I think that actually is an alternative goal that came more and more. But the original goal of flattening the curve was spread it out over time. Now, if that's your goal, you need to understand a couple of things. You need to understand the infection rate. If we don't do anything, how many people will get it? So is everybody susceptible, or will people already be immune? How fast will they get it, and how high will the peak be? Especially understanding the peak is very important. Number 2 is, you have to understand the health impact, because there's quite a lot of difference if this is more like SARS or more like, you know, a flu. So how bad is it when people become sick? And is it the same for everyone? Or does it have a lot more impact when somebody is older or obese, for instance? What's the capacity, number three, in the healthcare system we have to handle that? And finally, what's our finish line? Now, this is old news, but we once thought the finish line was maybe summer, because coronaviruses don't spread so well in summer, so then everything will be gone. Not a lot of people believe that anymore, though it will help a little bit. But will the finish line be the famous or now infamous herd immunity, or will it be a vaccine? Now, I used to entertain myself and the first listeners a lot with doing all these calculations, but I think we don't have the time for that right now, so you'll have to believe me somewhat for my word. But a lot has been published about it. But let's start with the infection rates. That's pretty simple. The R-naught, so it's more than 2, it's 2.3, as the RIVM says in the Netherlands. That means that if you ever done this with your kids, doubling up 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, low numbers in the beginning, but do it 20 times, so you're at a million. So the doubling time is around 5 days. So in about 100 days, without any interventions, we would have a peak of a million people, let's say. So that's good to remember. So here on the slide, we say conservatively more than 500,000, but probably even higher. So what's the health impact of that? Well, if we assume that it's spread evenly among the population, again, the original idea was that, if you look at the death rates in the Netherlands, around 10% or even more of the infected people appear to end up in mortality. This is clearly a gross overestimation because we're just testing only the most high-risk cases. So the positive cases you see in the news are the people who are actually have a very high risk of going to the hospital and dying. There are a lot of other researchers right now, like the Sangreen research on the infection fatality rate, which look more at the population. They seem to indicate, and we've done quite a lot of detailed analysis, which you can find online if you look at our articles, that it's on average probably more like 0.5% mortality and 0.3% IC. Even more extreme is the spread in populations. So the risk of somebody under 50 of actually dying from a COVID infection is less than 1 in 10,000. The risk of somebody 80 plus is maybe 1,000 times higher. So the average doesn't say a lot. So whenever you see anybody calculating with the average, just say it's meaningless. It's all about which age groups are infected. But if they would all be infected the same way, you can assess that if 0.5% or something goes to the IC, then if we have a million people getting it, we would need 5,000 IC beds. And people are not staying there for a week, but for 2 weeks, so we would need 10,000. Normally, we would have 300 available. We can scale up to 1,000, even to 2,000, but not so much. So even if this virus is much less serious in terms of individual health impact, as we originally thought, the law of the big numbers and the fact that everybody is susceptible and that 10 million people would get it in a short period of time suggests that we just cannot let that happen. So we will still need interventions. So that's also what you see on the right side of this graph. No interventions are not an option. Waiting for herd immunity, you can also calculate, not an option, because if we can only have 50 or 100,000 new infections a week to not overwhelm our capacity, and we need to get to 10 million, that takes 100 to 200 weeks, so that just takes longer than a vaccine. So we will have to hold out to a vaccine, which, you can debate a lot, but I think most people in the health system still expect it to be there for 12 to 18 months, maybe now 12 to 15 months. So summer of 2021 seems to be a good date. There's a lot of people saying but even if we have it, it won't be available for everybody. Well, it probably doesn't have to be. I think most people around this table and watching this don't need the vaccine. We need to make sure our 60 plus population gets it, and especially our 70 plus population. Long story short, we will need to hold out for a vaccine in 12 months. And then if we figure out that the vaccine won't happen, then we're in a new reality. But until that time, when we believe it will be there summer of 2021, we need to protect our older population. And unfortunately, ever since our last article, I've become a small icon of younger people in LinkedIn actually mailing me that they would love to use the research to explain why they can go to festivals again. But that's not entirely true, to be honest, because the reason the young people still cannot have it is because they'll present a much higher risk for the older population because we can't really isolate them. If you go to the next slide, but I already said it. So these are not the risks, but these are just the official numbers. So how many people have ended up in the hospital, in the IC, and in the immortality. And here you see the same picture that, the mortality under 50 is actually less than 1 in 1,000. less than 1 in 10,000. The ICU admissions are mostly concentrated between 50 and 80. That's important. People don't know that, but a lot of 80-year-olds don't make it into the IC in the Netherlands, also for their own volition. That's probably also one of the reasons that our IC hasn't been so overwhelmed as the one in Italy, where it's different. And then hospital distribution is a bit more varied. Going to what it means. So what it means is that the next 12 months we'll live in what we set a disruption interval world, where, you know, now we are in a good recovery, but now we're also going back to shops, we're going back to dinner, we're going back to flying maybe even. And, you know, logically speaking, that will just lead to more infections. Eh? And then the question is, will we start reaching that maximum again, that maximum of the curve? And if we do, we will need interventions. So it will be a shocky and bumpy ride. And hopefully we'll become increasingly sophisticated in our interventions. So we don't need the extreme ones we need now, but it will be a bumpy ride until the finish line, which is the vaccine for our most vulnerable populations. Now, what's important to understand for your business is the next slide, which is the escalation scheme. Now, this is an old one, and it will vary per country, and it also will be a lot more granular. But our way of thinking used to be that in the end, an intervention is avoiding a high-risk contact of an infected person with a non-infected person, and especially with a vulnerable non-infected person. Now, you can already imagine that in the beginning of an outbreak, when there are maybe 1,000 infected people and 16 or 17 million non-infected people, restricting the movement of 17 million non-infected people to prevent their contact with 1,000 infected people is kind of, that's shooting a cannon at a mosquito, right? It's a very, in the end, a lockdown, and I said it in the mildest possible way, because we did what we had to do in the first shock, but it's a quite medieval measure. Quarantine, by the way, also is a medieval word from the plague times. So number six here is a full lockdown, and it's what we should avoid at all costs. Now, clearly, number one is identify and isolate, what the Southeast Asian countries did well. Huh? Test a lot. Then when you know who has it, make sure you know who they were in contact with, and then isolate them. So that means investing in testing, tracking, tracing apps. That's why you saw all the discussions in the news. Now, if that works, that's great, and that's economically also great. That probably will not always work at all times, and especially not in all countries, and then we will go into working more from home. If we do that, and the 1.5 meter, the mouth masks, restricting transportations, etc. When that doesn't work, we'll go into canceling live events, sporting matches, etc. Then we'll go in closing the clubs, the bars, the restaurants, then the universities, the schools, and finally the shops, and a full lockdown, and nobody can go outside. What's important to understand here is clearly we won't go 0 to 1. Eh? So we won't just go like, oh, okay, now everything is fine, and then we do a full lockdown. It will go step by step. And the steps will be increasingly sophisticated, also because I would say that the political and societal draagvlak, support for the more extreme measures was quite high, actually, mid of March. But, you know, the more data comes out on the actual health impact and the more data comes out on the economic impact, the less support there will be for doing those measures again in the coming year, right? So we'll get into a more, let's say, intelligent and fluid system, and we'll also be more intelligent in making sure the peak doesn't go so high. So what you need to do as a company is you need to understand, if we go from 2 to 3, what does it mean for you? What does it mean for your ecosystem? And how can you prepare, and how can you see it coming? And you can check how it will go in your specific country, like the Netherlands, because it's also de-escalating this way. You know, and there are some local surprises. So in some countries, the gyms open first. In other countries, the gyms open last. It's not always completely scientifically proven. But understand what's going to happen by understanding how it de-escalates. And then you'll know in September when this hits again or peaks again, it will escalate again. Now, what nobody can predict, neither can we, is the economic impact of it. But aside from the health impact, what we also know is even if there's no COVID again, you know, even if there is no second wave, we will have an economic impact. Our main message is, when making your scenarios, don't make your scenarios like now you will be in the recovery phase continuously. You will get new shocks. So my final two slides, and then I'll wrap up for the panel discussion. Remember from the beginning, there are two worlds for your scenarios. There's next year, forgive me if it's 15 or 18 months or 9 months, but let's assume next year, disruption interval world. What you need to do, three things: understand your relative exposure, Are you the first to get hit or are you the last? And also understand this for your ecosystem, because if your ecosystem, if your suppliers will get hit earlier than you, this might be a great opportunity to help them and to strengthen your relationships. And then first is your competition in your industry, your relative robustness and your relative adaptivity. Where robustness, I would say, you know, your cash position, your infrastructure. I'm still, Hans, I can say it now, I'm pretty proud of Deloitte. I've been complaining about our network for a while, but you know, we switched in one day from doing everything live to 5,000 people doing Zooming and Teaming and et cetera online. I would say that's a competitive advantage if that works well, right? So that's infrastructure also online. Your culture and leadership, are your people still as productive, but also do they have the same risk behavior and safety behavior if you don't look them in the eyes live, right? So how's your culture and leadership? Your supply chain, I think companies who had a very effective global supply chain were punished quite harshly. Companies who had overcapacity had it easier, but you know, if there's a shortage of something, will you get it first, right? And your client base, how loyal is it, and will they come back more than your competition? So all these things, and there are much more, and I'm really curious on what Franca and Pierre will say about it later. But if you're more robust than your competitors, this is a great period to actually thrive. And adaptive is pretty similar to robust, but it's much more how fast can you switch? We once, in the early stages of the crisis, had a discussion, you know, if we would just be able to switch directly from live to virtual interaction with our clients and we wouldn't have any project freeze, then it doesn't really matter that much now, does it? So being adaptive, but also making sure that your entire client and supply chain base is adaptive is very important. And then the final slide, and then I'll finish up. So this is, the first was about the next year, the disruption interval year. Now there's the post-COVID year. And so I'm a healthcare guy and I can calculate a lot of health impact for you and I can predict some government interventions. I'm not an economic guru or truth sayer, so nobody knows. What's interesting is maybe even if you don't know who is right, you might be able to assess who is wrong and take the other side of the deal. I think that's a very important insight. Because what are typical ways you could be wrong, I would say? Well, one is if you just think that, you know, we had a tough period until end of May and then everything will be back to normal. I think we just stayed at that point. Next year will not be normal. But also if you now believe that a lot of the things that change now will change forever, because you have to separate what's actually a good idea to change, and then it will be an adoption curve that we will actually accelerate, and what's just a necessary evil. So a lot of things that have to do with mouth masks, 1.5 meter distance, and doing more online because the stuff we think is fun we can't do anymore, will probably come back. So yeah, I mean, I didn't like to fly all the time, you know, so maybe for business I'll fly a bit less and Zoom a bit more. But I really do like still to go on a beach in another country. So I don't really see why in 2 years, if the government doesn't forbid me, I wouldn't do it anymore. Now, this is not my Deloitte partner logic. This is my personal logic. But I think everybody can make that logic for themselves. So what you see is, you know, of course, you know, a lot of non-food retail CFOs tell me, like, yeah, when our shops closed, our online sales increased 600%. But when they reopened, it went back to 102%, right? So if you are able to assess which actual changes have a better consumer experience and separate them from the rest and say if in a year those will come back, and we all know they won't end up back at 100, but they won't be 200 as well, they might be 110. If you can assess that better than your competition and you can place your bets the right way, I think you're well prepared for the post-COVID world. Well, that's my short story.
Your speech. Thanks. Thank you very much, John. I am especially keen to hear from the audience now, because you've talked a lot about also the societal discussion and how businesses initially have mostly responded to issues. I think for the purpose of today, we'd also like to hear a little bit on more the strategic way forward. How do you actually thrive in this new environment? And you've done a great job explaining more or less what people should expect for the next 12 to 18 months. Although it's not the prettiest of messages, maybe for some. We're going to have a poll. I believe that everyone will see the poll questions already turning up on the screen. It will be around the initiatives that one would have adopted to structurally change your business model and the way you work. And I'm quite keen to hear if the people on the other side of this camera will have either launched several initiatives and plan to keep these, or if some initiatives were actually started, but only for just the interim phase that you spoke about. Maybe some are actually thinking about implementing some changes structurally, but don't know where to start, which is obviously a fair answer actually to give. And some might actually say that, no, we actually don't think that this is necessary. And while we wait for the answers to come in, I want to quickly move to you, Hans, because I'm assuming you've spoken to many executives in the past, well, two months.
Yeah, that's true.
Could you make a prediction of what others will say here?
I think that many have thought about the measures already. So that will be high. So at the end of the day, I think already took some actions, 40% and 60% are considering.
Wow. All right. Well, we are now at 61% of we have launched several initiatives. This is not prescripted. And 60% says, yeah, we have actually some initiatives and we're planning to keep these. So that is a positive news story, I think. 21% says we've implemented some initiatives, but they are really just for the time being. And a small 5% thinks that no specific structural changes are necessary. Compared to what you thought, more or less resonates?
Yeah, it's what I said in the introduction. That's the share of mind after the first 2 weeks of real crisis management, people start to rethink their strategy, evaluating. That's what we've done ourselves. So what's our strategy? What are our initiatives? What are we going to double down on? Which are we going to temporize? I think it's quite a logical response. Yeah.
Thank you. I do have a question for you, John, from the audience, to our sort of our neighbors in Sweden. How do you explain the Swedish method? And would that not be a better model for us as well?
Yeah. Well, you know, it's always easier in hindsight, I would say, right? So. I'm personally deeply in awe almost of the bravery of the Swedish virologist who made up that model and the Swedish government, because I think it would be I think they were right. It was also a politically extremely risky choice, right? Because what is the cost of being right and wrong in different scenarios? If you do a lockdown and you're wrong, but everybody does the lockdown, you're just one of the group. If you don't do a lockdown and you're wrong, you'll be forever remembered, you know, as a person killing a large part of the population. So they didn't do it as one of the standouts, and they were right. I would say they're right. And I think that's also something we're going to see in the Netherlands. So that's basically one of the things I'm trying to tell, that I would be very careful in judging or criticizing our government, because I think the way we handled it with the information at the time was good and was more subtle and more intelligent and more swift than a lot of other countries did, like Spain or et cetera, or the UK. I would also imagine that the next waves that will hit us, we will be more intelligent in the way we respond, and we will be less focused on just minimizing the health risk, and we will more have the weighing of the economic and societal impacts. Yeah. So that's why lesser disruptions will follow.
All right. Yeah. Thanks, John. I think it would be a good time to actually move to our panel, who are sitting here keenly waiting for us to ask some questions. So again, the plea to the audience to actually do use your QR code for questions. Are you okay with me starting off? So have you experienced, as the CEO of the Royal, of your company, how did you experience the last 2 months?
Well, I experienced a very interesting period of time, because in a leadership position, you always have things in mind that you really would thrive to in your business, and a crisis can also speed up things. So I think it's a very interesting time if you're in this position and in all the leadership positions in the company to go through this. And personally, I like it because it's also, it sounds a bit strange, but it's also comfortable in these times, because I think if you're well prepared, and you make your decisions very fast, and we did that, it also brings a lot of rest in the company. So I see a lot of good things happening as well, although the business, of course, has a lot of problems because of the HoReCa business and the lockdown and the social distancing measures. But I see that also a lot of positive things are happening, like people collaborating in the right way together, more decisiveness, more speed in the company. People working are very flexible, responding very flexible. And I personally would like if we can continue on that. So we need to learn from this period of time to be better in the future. That's the biggest challenge for us, I think.
Still an optimistic story, though. That's yeah. An optimistic mindset, at least.
Yeah.
Great. How's that for you, Franca?
Well, it's I totally agree with Pierre. It's a very interesting period. I came to Jabus in 2016, and we were making quite big losses. So we really changed the organization the last couple of years, and we were more or less celebrating the best year ever in 2019. And then focusing on our strategic direction, speeding up with Samsung, our strategic partnership we have with Samsung Global, making sure that the live event and the data and digital come together. And then certainly in January we get the message in China, one of our subsidiaries, that there's some kind of virus and the event industry will be completely down or postponed. And then you think, okay, this will not come to Europe, but then 2 months later, of course, we are also completely affected. First thing you do is some crisis management. Luckily, we had built up the cash position last couple of years, so we have many time. We have time to really rethink what our strategic direction is. How we continue. We are really focusing on data, digital, and innovation. We are even accelerating that. Just making sure that we take the right measures now for the coming period. And of course, every time when Mark Rutte is mentioning new information, our scenarios are recalculated and we need to rethink what is the impact on the Jabus, which is of course huge.
So is that also a learning that you would like to send out, is more or less while you take responsive measures, also take that leap forward and see how you can take thriving actions to actually see how do we change?
Yeah, of course, the cash position gives us the ability to really rethink about the measures, but it's also, for the longer term, it's a challenge. Yeah? It's also something we believe in the live event even more, in combination with data, digital, and technology. And I think we are accelerating on that part, just to make sure that we have the competitive advantage. We can be distinctive, and that's what we are still aiming for.
Great, I like to see the optimism of both sides of the room. If you were to mention one of the current biggest obstacles you still face as a company, Pierre.
Well, in the first 3 months, we saw the lockdown of HoReCa and also event business impacted hugely also the beer business. But also the maltery business, we are active in both. And it had a direct impact. What will happen now with the opening up is a completely other world, I think, because what's going to happen in the next coming months and year is which companies are going to survive. Because lots of companies will have bankruptcies, is my belief, in our business, not the beer business as such, but also the total chain. We will face a lot of bankruptcies. How are we going to handle that as a company? That will be one of the main challenges, I think, for the year ahead now.
The total overview of your chain, your sector, and everything that's going to change in there in terms of which companies do stand up and which companies actually deteriorate.
Yeah, exactly. Of course, we are a beer brewer, but we are also a real estate business. We are also in banking to HoReCa business. We are also a supplier company, a distribution company. So we have different roles in this chain. And so we have different impact also to within a company.
Yeah. So, Franca, if you were to look at your sector, do you see changes that you would deem sort of focused completely and temporary, and others might be completely there to stay in the totality of your sector and in which you operate? Changes that you see there.
Yeah, of course, the sector, if you have like, we are like completely down at this moment, and there's still a question mark when we can reopen on the large scale we really need to make profit. What I said, we are at Jaarbeurs, we are locally driven, so we are organizing lots of events for the local Dutch market. If you look, example, for our competitors like Rai, they are really focused on the international business. They will have different challenges with people not traveling. Sustainability is becoming is having a more impact. So the competitive landscape on the short term will change, and on the longer term, I still think we are taking the right strategic direction. We already took it, and we are accelerating to make sure that we are, in the end of the day, also making sure we are trying to win. We see lots of business opportunities as well coming. For example, if you have the 1.5 meter society, lots of locations cannot, handle the traffic, and we can. So there's also lots of business opportunities will still come.
So what would be your tip for other businesses out there on how do you get so positive? Well, maybe they've just recovered from responding to this particular phase.
Yeah, what would be your tip? I think a tip would be is we are recalibrating the strategy every couple of months, and we are still doing that, making sure that you keep all your eyes open for the things which are happening in the environment. But also taking the measures and don't wait. So for the short term, we are really, if we see that 2021 will be half of our revenues, then we cannot wait till it's going over. So we really should take the measures, and that's what we are preparing.
Okay.
Yeah.
And as a person, I see you talk about also the opportunity that comes with this phase. Which opportunities do you see or spot in the sector, maybe in general, that that one can take, that they really overcome and just be adaptable to the change?
Yeah, the opportunities are, on one side is the way you work as a company, a new way of work, setting a new way of working, which is probably more effective and more efficient. That's an opportunity, in my opinion. The other opportunity is in the business. If you look in our business, then probably there in the merger and acquisition part of the business, there could be opportunities in the upcoming period, because there are healthy companies struggling now, and they are going to rethink what is my future, what is the best owner of our company, and that can be an opportunity.
Hans, what's your thought
on
that?
I fully agree. Maybe going back to your first question about, and then I will answer the question about the opportunity, but about how I've experienced the past months. First of all, I've quite similar, energized, and also very proud of my organization. People are so focused, are collaborating very well. So, and then what I find an interesting question, why do we need a crisis to become so focused? I find it as a leader, an interesting question, and I don't. It is about, of course, the immense case for change, really a call for action. But how can we keep that spirit moving forward? That's an interesting question. And secondly, what is interesting that you need to make it. Both Pierre and Franke were saying you need to take decisive actions. And then, but how do you do that if you don't have real insights or data, what my lesson there is that it then is really about your purpose and values, some principles. So even you don't know, but then certainly we have a people business, and then it's really about some of the principles where we stand for, and that then gives a lot of guidance, even without having all data, which of course we prefer. But then, yeah. And then back to the opportunity question. Yeah. I agree with Pierre. So in times of crisis, market leaders stand up. And then it is, I think, extremely important to have a very clear strategy. And if you're in a good shape, that will offer a lot of opportunities. And in M&A, building capabilities that you don't have. And what Franca was saying, and that's what I hear from a lot of the decision makers is actually accelerate the most crucial transformations. And of course, we as Deloitte are heavily focused on what technology means for business and operating models. We think that there's a very long-term trend, and that offers for us, apart from the short-term impact, will in the longer term offer opportunities.
And what would your tip be for companies still dealing maybe with the first set of measures, the first sort of the response side? I mean, how do they come to grips with the new information that is constantly changing, new scenarios every week with market data coming up? Have you seen experiences from talking to other executives on how they deal with that? Planning is the key word, maybe?
I think that, yeah, but I think that most have gone through that phase.
Okay.
I'm impressed by the crisis management. Everyone has scenarios, and I don't think you can refine scenarios endlessly. I don't think that's ultimately the solution. And then it's about really thinking about your competitive position, your business model. Pierre was saying the difference in his business lines, and Franca, the relative position of the Jaarbeurs compared to the RAI, and thinking that through and what kind of opportunities it gives is extremely important. And what's also important, it gives energy. Because that's a key factor as well, that your people, certainly when, in our case, probably the difficult period will come, we're quite resilient now, but we don't know what will happen. And then it's important people think about opportunities and the upside.
All right. So a lot of positive news, I think. This is also where we're here today, to talk about thriving in this new environment. It might be good to open the floor for a question, at least already from the audience, because I see a couple of coming in. I think one is for you, because you touched base on the M&A opportunity, more or less, in a broader sense. Do you think this is the correct time, that's the question, to engage in M&A activity into technology-based assets for large corporates, or should they focus on keeping a strong cash position instead of longer-term investments?
Of course, the first priority is cash position in every company, but we are a family-owned company, mm-hmm. and for most family-owned companies, they are quite conservative, normally, in finance perspective. So they build up some cash, of course, over time, and that helps, of course, in a period where there's a crisis. You can also look at the anti-cycle way of thinking. For those companies that are able to do that. Not every company, of course, can do that because, for example, they had a lot of debt building for the last few years. You saw a lot of companies, of course, building a lot of debt over the last years. And that will be very difficult for those companies, but the family-owned businesses have probably a big opportunity there at the moment.
Exactly. Yeah. Any thoughts from you, Hans, on... what Pierre is saying, do you see other companies react similar with that question?
No, I agree. And by the way, we as a partnership, by the way, are also in a sense a kind of, we're not on the stock exchange. So that gives some more flexibility and also indeed conservatism in the sense of how you're financed. So that will, that is definitely helps. Key priority, by the way, is of course for us as well in our business, is first of all always liquidity, and it's more Franca's topic.
What would be your question to Franca? Your ultimate question. if you were to ask Franca your most burning question, which one would it be as a CFO? Hans,
do you have also the I'm thinking about a question which is difficult to answer. There are questions that Franca probably won't answer in a panel with 250 participants. So I think what's from your, what is the, do you also have the yeah, no, that is too specific. What do you see as the largest opportunities you have currently?
Well, one of the largest opportunities that we can really redesign Jaarbeurs again. It's always difficult to change the scale of an organization with lots of people. And this is also a chance to refocus business-wise, activity-wise, and design the organization as such. So that's, I think, a large opportunity. And also what Peer said and what you said, business opportunities come in a crisis. Certainly for a company as Jabeurs, because we are quite, we have a good cash position. Yeah. I think we focus on the right things. So, of course, we need to take measures for the short term. We can redesign the organization. We can combine online and offline with each other, and business opportunities will come, and we will take them.
Yeah, and you were referring to your China business the cooperation you have there. Also, that it's quite important in your strategy in terms of mixing online with your physical businesses.
Yeah, that's more, I think, how we are designed in the Netherlands. In China, that's, well, it's of course also similar, but China is a completely different world. What we see over there is that already lots of business opportunities are seen for the coming period. Everybody is thinking, okay, I really need to be at that event, because if I'm not there, I'm going to lose market. So I think China is much more optimistic about the future and the growth perspective. In the Netherlands, it's just a bit different.
Yeah, I see.
You see a very, you see the market over there very quickly accelerating. And okay, we've done it, we've had it, we are reopening, and we see business opportunities. So the market and the people are different.
And do you see large differences appear in your business across countries?
Yeah, but that very much depends on is it retail focused or HoReCa focused and event focused. So one of the key questions I have for post-corona is, you see now because of the lockdown, young people last 20 years in their habits for going out, they went to festivals, big events. Now the HoReCa is opening up, but the event business is not opening up. So young people are going to traditional bars and maybe clubs, etc., in the upcoming year. And what's going to happen after COVID? Are they going back to the big festivals and big events, or are they going to stick and we go back to the 80s and the 90s? Yeah. What is the habit of young consumers? Because in our business, that's important. That's an important part of the business.
Yeah. And how do you would like to get better insight? Have you already thought about it? How you scenarios, of course, but are there other ways you try to find an answer to it?
Of course, we also did the scenario planning, and that's more based on the thing that John was just mentioning. If you look to the interval economy in the upcoming year, how many intervals are we going to plan in our scenarios? So we did several scenarios, from one interval to several intervals, and then with also a longer period of time. And that really learns us how we can not only react, but also can thrive better to a future post-COVID. Having our strategy in mind, of course, because we had a strategy, we are going to stick to the strategy, we are going to speed up a few things, and we have to slow down a few things. But in the end, the direction is very clear.
I do have another question from the audience. Are you okay? Mm-hmm. All right. It's actually a question around brand trust, or trust of employees and customers in your brand. On the back of the medical crisis, how are you adapting? Sort of, what do you do to change the trust in the brand, or to change on an employee and customer level?
Yeah, you have several brands, of course. Yeah. We have the brands for products, and we have the company brand, in fact. What we did in the last 3 months is, because it's also part, I think, of the DNA of our company, that we have, of course, as a family-owned business, we are there to earn money, but we are also there to have profits for society. So not only for us, but also for society. And it's also interesting to ask yourself a question, what can you do for society in these corona crisis? And this corona crisis. And we produced hand alcohol.
Exactly. You did something, right?
Yeah. We were the first to produce hand alcohol. We delivered that to 1,200 hospitals and other care centers in the Netherlands. That was a big project. We started in the beginning of the crisis. That was just out of a question we got from a hospital, and we made a team to react very fast to that. And it was very nice to see that other partners were going to help us in that case. And at the moment you're doing that, your own people are very much motivated, and other people are going to help you as well from outside your company. And then our competitors also followed that initiative. So in the end, we were impacting a lot during the crisis on also a societal issue we are facing at the moment. And that was also, I think, which gives us a lot of trust in the end.
Yeah, brand trust. So Franca, how do you keep motivating your employees under these circumstances? Anything you do in particular?
I think we are communicating very very much with our employees, and we're always making sure that the collaboration is good, informing them also, but also making sure that they are looking into new business opportunities. And the people are motivated. Jabes is more like a family, so people are motivated anyway. We can really see that. We really see that they are still doing that. Some departments are also working very, very hard. Management is working very hard. Departments, finance department is working hard. There are many departments also. HR is working very hard. So many staff, people also need to work hard to make sure that everything is.
It's also a shared community feeling of we're all facing the similar problem. Let's at least work at this
and
together.
And maybe
right?
Also good to mention, we are also part of a chain, and the customers, if we stop an event, we also need to make sure that we inform and we have the contacts as well with suppliers as with our exhibitors. Sales is really, really, really communicating a lot to make sure that they are still in talks, making sure that you're also the partner in the future.
Hans.
I agree, and there's communication, but also thinking about the broader impact also on society, building up Pompeo's point is extremely important. So, because it's for your brand, but also actually motivating your people, it goes back to our own purpose. And I think also in the longer term, it will have large impact on society, what's happening in terms of the impact, in terms of the vulnerable groups in society will be hit hardest. So it will even make some of the challenges we have larger. And I think that we as corporates also have a role to play there with all our capabilities, think about it. And that's, I think, another longer-term impact of the crisis.
Thanks, Hans. I do have a final question for you, Peer. What tips would you have for family-owned businesses? I think specifically maybe for family-owned businesses, if any.
Yeah. Well.
Well.
The last question, huh?
Well, a minute. Maybe one thing. That's it.
Yeah. Exactly. I think for family-owned businesses specifically, I think that this is a time to rethink what are the main reasons why I exist, and to bring those thoughts further to what is the reason why the hell is our company on earth and where should we head to? Knowing all the learnings you get from the crisis. So that could be a main question for every company, but for a family-owned business, you're always looking ahead one generation ahead or two generations ahead because we have our company in loan of our children and that's the... So you can also think more ahead, and this time can be a nice time for that.
So maybe more of an existential question, and then what do I leave future generations?
Yeah, exactly.
All right, I think time is up. I would like to thank everybody for their participation. I understood that an email will follow with a recording of this webinar, and we're very thankful for the interaction that we face. So have a great day, and thanks everyone for joining.